Dr. Fred Cook is this year's recipient of the Olney Medal Award for his wide-ranging contributions to the field of polymer textile chemistry applied to sustainable developments in textile carpet processes and novel fiber materials innovations. Dr. Cook's pioneering work over the past 40 years on energy conserving sustainable dyeing technologies such as automated dyeing, dye batteries, is and continues to be a major interest for the textile carpet industries. His research has also impacted cotton-containing yarn slashing and fabric preparation processes. Later in his career, Fred conducted research in solvent-assisted dye printing of aramid fabrics and in inkjet printing. His contributions to the synthesis and characterization of novel anisotropic polyesters for high-performance applications are particularly noteworthy. Dr. Cook's work has exemplified the importance of visionary thinking and turning ideas tested in the laboratory into practical products and processes. Dr. Cook.
Thank you. Thank you, Sandy, and appreciate everybody coming in. I told Jack, I think it's the first 8 o'clock presentation I've made in over 30 years. I generally avoid this type of thing, so I appreciate you coming out to serve. We'll be talking over a number of areas this morning, and of course, I've only got about 40 minutes or so to get through them. So I know I won't finish this number of slides, but they will be posted on the website. So if you want to go back and look at some areas that I'm not going to be able to get to, they'll be on there. So I titled it up as 40 Years of Wonders, and Dick asked an answer, was that the right spelling? And it indeed is. And it's hard to find a conference when you're in university research today. That's one of the major changes that you get vis-a-vis industry research, and that is universities care less what you work on, as long as you find the funding to support it. One, and Haskell over here nodding her head at that detail. So I took full advantage of that. I was at DuPont at the experimental station initially, pioneered the laboratory, and made the switch to Tech in 1975. And as you can tell from the slides, I've really taken advantage of that freedom. It really has kept me at the top of the field, but mainly kept my interest level high. And really has done a good job. So that leading in, let's go into the first area. We turn to combined desalinized sterile bleach. Opportunities were obvious when we began to think about what we could do to optimize the process. We were literally into sustainable processes before the word became popular at that point in time. The concurrent continuous process, as you know, requires three distinct steps, and continuous line is what we were looking at, and that is desalinized sterile bleach, and it is literally a hauler, if you want to use that word. It takes up half the plant, large-scale equipment. Each set of the processes require a separate desalinized pad, nip, followed by steaming and then washing. So the research approach we took was to come up with a combination of chemicals that will allow us to give us fully prepared fabric in one step. In other words, reduce the process by two-thirds by simply going to a single pad, single steaming, and then finally a single washing to get fully prepared fabric that was, in this case, a side corollary, of course, with an inverse product. Working with our partner, which is Westmore Home. So that's the purpose of it. And again, this is the actual continuous process, as you know. And then this is what we're looking to do. Again, come up with a single pad, single seam, single wash type of process. So we look naturally at the chemicals that we use in scouring, being our baseline. It does contain a lot more sodium hydroxide than we use catalyst and bleaching. So we did use sodium silicate, we used a chelate, and a surfactant that would help get this load of impurities off the fabric and out of the solution. And the key came down in initial work with hydrogen peroxide. We knew we had to use a complete organics in there coming off of the material. So hydrogen peroxide was obviously going to be consumed at a prodigious rate that seemed coming to us. So we had to compensate for that. And we spent roughly a year working around trying to optimize hydrogen peroxide to do everything we needed. And fortunately, we didn't get to the point we needed to on whiteness. The company standard was running about 77 on a whiteness scale. We were running about 70. So we finally gave up on that approach, and this work, by the way, was done by a team of students. Warren Perkins was involved. It was part of the, at that time, the sectional paper competition. So we then began to look around for another peroxide that we could add into the process that would be stable enough under the extremist scouring conditions that would give us the final whiteness we needed at the end of the process. And eventually we came down to a mouthful here, tetrapotassium peroxide phosphate, TPP, that FMC Corporation had come up with a new process to make it. It was an electrolytic process, and they had enough pilot scale production to supply us with the pounders we needed to do our lab research. So we did try that after looking at a number of competitors, and it worked. We were able to then use our bug formulation we had developed earlier, and only adding about 1% weight over weight KPP to it, it got us up to that 77 whiteness level that we needed. So it was indeed a magic chemical as far as the process was concerned. And we went on from there to look at some pilot scale of it and determined it was successful and the right way to go. It was my first experience, though, coming up with a great technical success that we had difficulty translating into production. And the reason was nobody in the world, believe it or not, at that time, and I still think it's true, was producing KPP on a commercial scale. We found one small chemical company in Siberia, Soviet Union, that was actually selling it. So the industry was eager to try it out. They had two or three partners that were willing to run trials on it. But unfortunately, we couldn't give them anything but a pilot scale supply out of FMC. So FMC took that to you, well, great, this is fantastic, but using such a small amount, we can't justify setting up a greenfield plant to produce KPP. We're going to have to find other markets, like one thing we're looking at that you might be interested in, a substitute for, I think it was a benzoyl peroxide that they were using in Clearasil. All of you familiar with the product Clearasil. So that was, as I said, my first experience with having technical success, but a commercial failure because we still haven't gotten anybody into the production level KPP. We have had some offshoots. We've got a number of companies that we've worked with that have gone, for instance, Light Springs Industries at the Griffin Finishing Plant. We later got into combined desized scour with septic bleach. Another company that actually went all the way with the process without KPP was 1888 Mills in Griffin, again. They are using today, and they're using institutional towels that don't have as high whiteness requirement as the polyester cotton we used earlier. So they are using the complete DSP process as we speak. Next area is dyeing premium nomex. When we started work in this area, Southern Mills, now Penn College, at Union City, Georgia, were the main producers of colored nomex in the U.S. They partnered up with us. They put out a RFP at that point, basically asking, was anybody out there that was able to print nomex for the first time? They wanted to go to camouflage on more soldiers, and they had the field at that time, especially folks that were in enclosed environments and susceptible to flames. So we built off this early work that we had done with a process out of Rome, Long. They had developed it as a bee dyeing operation for touch and nylon carpet. And the beauty of it is it was a total closed-loop process, built basically off of a platform of a fancy dry cleaning operation. They used a mixture of 10% methanol and 90% perchloroethylene and perch, dry cleaning solvent of choice, of course. And the route is based mainly on a differential boiling point between methanol and perch. So basically, anidase, in their case, anidase, the only thing they looked at, acidase, were soluble in the mixture, but they weren't soluble in the non-polar perch. So by distilling off the methanol slowly, the dye then only had two choices. Unfortunately, the choice was to move on to the factory. So we felt it had credibility in terms of dyeing the Nomex, which was very difficult at that time. Some mills was based on acetophenone as the only known carrier that they used to dye in their Nomex fabric. And acetophenone, if you've been around, is a severe lactamator. The nose can pick it up in parts per million levels. It's not a very nice chemical to be using on fabrics. Every product that some mills produced at that point smelled of acetophenone, and it's going to get it washed out. So we felt that we could possibly dye Nomex using this new SGX system because the solubility parameters and so forth look decent to us between these two solvents and the fabric. So we used that, and this is a picture of the SGX process on nylon. A Belgian company picked it up in Mont Blanc and ran it for about 6 or 7 years. In their plants, you can see it's a bean dyeing operation, and worked very, very well commercially. So we use the process with work on a commercial basis. So we began doing research on it using the regular lines of the wet process on jet machines at that time at the company, and we were able to match all of the shades that we in their dominant line, no problem at all. Batch properties were great. Process that left no odor in the fabrics. We were able to get 100% recovery, basically, of the solvents by going through it. And we then got a little bit eager. We decided to look at Kevlar as being kind of the ultimate. And we were able to get medium shades on staple Kevlar, but not on filament. If you think about it, that strong sheath core arrangement in Kevlar, what we're doing on staple is obviously diffusing from the ends of the fiber, not through the sheath. And with filament, of course, we didn't have that opportunity. So all we were able to do was get medium shades on staple Kevlar fabrics, not on filament, basically only a tenth there. But we were able to conclude that the system is a viable, closed-loop, waterless process for solid-shade batch coloration of Nomex fabrics. And at that time, we were using type 455, which is the sulfonated aromatic co-monitor that allows cation dyes to hit. So this one, again, some mills that literally just brought in jets to replace vets about 2 years before. Process, if you would imagine, is more capital intensive than a jet machine. First of all, methanol is a flammable solvent. So they elected not to go to it at that time. It would take too big a write-off loss. But it is there, and it has been proven. We literally can now go out in the middle of the desert, if you like, and set up a dyeing process for textiles with anion dyes or cation dyes without any need for water at all. Basically, again, dry cleaning type operation. Okay. So, we then turned to training. As I said, we got an RFP that came out in '80. Some of the mills were willing to partner with us. The military was eager to get more camouflage and Nomex fabrics out there, but unfortunately, they gave it up. They basically put out an RFP and said, we can't figure out how to do it. Anybody out there got any ideas? So, after working with the chemical producer that was working with Southern Mills out of Dalton, Georgia, for about 6 months on the project, it became obvious that they were trying to use conventional printing technique. You just couldn't do it, couldn't get a good enough body to achieve, and failed pretty miserably. And I finally said, look, guys, I'm going to do something different here. Let's go to a solvent that has, again, some solubility parameters with no mix. Let's plasticize it, and then maybe we can print it at that point. So that was a breakthrough that literally came up with the first successful process for printing no mix. We literally went to DMSO, dimethyl sulfoxide, nice, cheap, all product of the craft paper process. So brought it in and just basically padded it on, nipped it, and then dried it at about 8 degrees C to drive the solvent into the fiber, and then that allowed us to overprint it with regular printing types of process. So some bills went on and eventually farmed it out to an outside producer, but that was the process they used to go to it. Burlington Industry Lab picked it up. So this literally became the starting point for the camouflage printing of nomads. Okay, now let's turn to the apis knot. This is out of a 12th century, a 13th century book out of England. And even though we've gotten a lot fancier, they had all the basics even at that early age. You got your two guys up here that are using the rotation point to get agitation. You got a fire built underneath the container with wood. And you got your old dyer over here overseeing the operation, making sure everything's okay. So we had all the basics very early in the game. And I thought you'd like to see this out of the same book. Some of the chemicals they were using at that point in time, of course, were natural colors. And it looks like a pretty smelly process inside the biological library. Nice. So you look at what we're doing today, exhaust dyeing. This is the starting point on the left at the end. And looking at it, we decided very early in the game, this is right after I came into tech, that there were some opportunities here to possibly convert a batch process into a semi-continuous process. The point at that time was to simply dial one batch of fabric in a big pot of water and then have it hot. The dyes were in pretty good shape at that point. The auxiliary chemicals that were left were not destroyed, and basically all that went down the drain with big pollution costs and water loss and energy loss. So the concept was to take a look at these two and see what we could do in terms of analysis so that we could continuously reuse the same bottle of water for dyeing multiple batches. So one thing we figured out fairly early, the auxiliary chemicals were there in huge excess. You know, the philosophy of if this is enough, then this much is better. So we didn't have to analyze those, which has been difficult since they're colorless. The dyes were there in very small quantities, usually around about 92-93% exhaustion. And we did have good spectrophotometric techniques that were cheap and easy to use. We first had to answer, before we did that though, the question of how are you going to avoid the impurity buildup interfering with your later dyes. And we showed that by the fact that you have about 25% bath loss each time to the goods. When you drop the bath out, the goods, of course, retain some liquid. So we have to replace about 25% of the water on each reuse dyeing. And as a result of that, those impurities that are building up, which are things like spin finish, et cetera, plateau off. And Chuck Carr worked with me on this and showed the plateauing of the impurities, and as long as they can build up to a concentration of volume over about 5 to 10 cycles, then you can literally dye continuously then without worrying about impurities interfering with the process. And luckily they did. We found out in research that this modeling was accurate, that we didn't have to worry about the impurity build up after about 5 cycles. So spectrophotometrically, I'm all of you aware of things like transmittance and absorbance and those types of things. So we use straight visible spectrophotometry as a way to analyze it. And of course, when you go to three dyes, like in the trichromatic series, the red, yellow, blue, and if you have to add an orange, that's the fourth one, you have to be able to bath at the end of the cycle, and then fill in with his own K-concepts, and you saw the 3x3 with three unknowns in terms of concentration. So in the early days, we did this totally by hand, worked out well. We were able to train plant operators then to carry it on to the plants. We'll see some examples of that later. And then finally, we ended the research up with a major project to demonstrate it on a plant scale in Dalton, Georgia, and Shaw Industries on Allied Park. So this is a long laundry list. I won't read over, but these are the steps that we went through as we got to the end of the cycle, then analyze the bath again by hand, and then determine from the equations what concentration or what dyes we needed to add for the next cycle. We had to add enough auxiliaries to make up 25% of water, and then we basically pumped the dye bath back in and off and running again. And there is a time savings here that we never had tried to quantify well, but we were starting these dyes at about 150 F. We found that we were getting cooling and pumping out to the dye bath. You also have that 25% of cold water that's coming in, and the goods that you bring in are cold. So we were able to save that much energy, though, between normal room temperature, 72 F and 150 F. That also saved time each cycle, because we only had to heat up from 150 to the boil after that pull back in. So on our research, these are the areas that we proved the alpha theses. Wayne Tedger and myself had about 5 theses done in the area. And these were the type things that we showed could indeed work through multiple cycles. And some things we learned, though, we had to follow the pattern of light series and medium series and dark series. We showed conclusively we couldn't go in the reverse direction. So it does require some scheduling in a plant where you run a series of light shades, then switch over to medium, and finally end up the cycle with sequence with dark. We could change one of the dyes, could change more than one. Say we wanted to switch red in the middle of the run, we could do that without having to completely drop the bath and start over. And as I said earlier, we could start the dye hot as long as the dye bath was less than 160 L. And the goods, again, retained about 25% of spent dye bath after the drop. So the plant demonstration, about a 2-year, $800,000 project by the Department of Energy. This showed the modified dyes on the nylon carpet in a bed at Shaw Industries. You can see the regular process up here at the top, and of course the modified process here at the bottom. And we had two engineers. Georgia Tech does have a lot of them. So we brought in Jim Clark, who is a mechanical engineer, PhD, to help us with the process. And Wiley Holcomb, who was a computer expert, also an MBE, to help us design the automated system. Because one thing we wanted to demonstrate was that you don't have to have a trained technician to do this by hand. It takes about 30 minutes. So this process was developed so that we could take a sample automatically, carry it through a filtration system, and then pump it into a cell and a spectrophotometer, and we literally were able to show that we could get an answer within about 30 seconds. From the time we matched the button to start the process to the time that we had an answer of what we needed to do in a printout for the next dyeing, we were able to do on this demonstration about 30 seconds versus 30 minutes by hand. So this is a picture of the analytical setup that we built. We've still got that available, of course, at Dalton. And this is a set of reefs that we went through. These are the style, shades, fiber, and we're looking in this case for 6.6. And these are the results that we had. The only one we had multiple ads on was the bottom one, and the plant told us not to worry about a single ad. Most of their runs, they required at least one ad, so they were well pleased with this. And it was only the last one that had to do 3 ads, and finally that one downgraded and redied. So these are the analytical results of the savings that are going through here. Again, consists on materials, water, et cetera. It doesn't include time savings and added productivity. These are just the numbers. And these are the cents per pounds the carpet saved by going to a dynamic reuse sequence. And as you can see, it's pretty substantial. 3 cents a pound of goods. Doesn't sound like much when you look at 1 pound, but you gotta remember, they run these things 24/7 and you're dying as much as 2,000 pounds each batch. So it is very, very substantial in terms of savings. So these are just a couple of the commercial successes we've had. This was one of the first ones. It was Ed's Black Carpet at that time, now owned by Shaw. They were dying with 18 bits on the floor, polyester carpet, face fiber, and they elected running using holding tanks to use an empty bed. They found out by scheduling that they always had an empty bed somewhere, so they put in a manifold, and when they got ready to drop the dye valve, they just figured out which bed was empty, and then turned the valve and shot it to it as a holding tank. So they operated for several years, going up to many 60 batches of carpet before they made it. Dropped the sewer of that final bath. This one was at Southern Mills again. They eventually ran into deep trouble with a sealed phone. When they bought the jet machines, for instance, they no longer had sealed phone going out into the air, but it all went to their treatment pod, POTW, and then we set it. So by the time we got involved with them, put in about that reuse, they were literally shipping by tanker truck to South Carolina, disposing of dye valves as toxic waste, which was killing them financially. So we were able to get them over pretty quickly in the reuse at this point, and they operated about 3 years, again, 50, 60 batches before a drop, before a more benign carrier was developed and brought in. They then switched off of it and went to the Olney carrier to seal it up. Okay. Next one is the more recent one we've done. We have a need in the carpet industry to speed up continuous lines of headway carpet. They were running 35-ounce, 30-ounce, that low weight of carpet fine in terms of speeds, but they had to drop those speeds to literally about 10 yards a minute when they went to residential 60, 70 ounces per square yard carpet. So they challenged us to come up with a way that we could hopefully speed that process up because they wanted to get it off the batch machine. As you know, it's always more cost effective to run things continuous than it is by batch. So Homie Dong was the main research scientist on this, and Chuck Carr was the engineer with him. This was the setup that they had initially, and this is the problem that we were addressing. You can see going from 20 ounces per square yard to 130 feet per minute all the way down to around 25 feet per minute when we had to go to 60 ounce stuff. So that bottleneck is what we addressed, and I later used a technology that had come out of Brueggemann Corporation several years before. This is called the mock nozzle. It was used on mercerization machines that Brueggemann was building to literally blow water out of fabric. And it is a slot device that you build up a pressure with, and the term Mach nozzle comes from the fact that you can generate Mach 1 velocities of the steam that's coming out. So I used it earlier with a thesis with, let's see, Keller, last name. Can't remember the first name. But anyway, she showed that we actually could dye carpet with just Mach nozzle steam without using a formal steamer if we ran slow enough and got full condensation of the steam. So we went to that device, and this is the experimental setup that we used in the technology applications lab to set it up. And the concept was to basically put the mock nozzle before the steamer in order to preheat and bring the carpet up to temperature before it actually got into the mock steamer. As you know, if you go in the steamer dry, you're basically going to pick up enough heat to bring the water up to boil, and it's probably halfway through the steamer before it reaches full temperature. So that's basically the concept. This is some of the pictures of the setup that two-foot sample we had going under the mock nozzle at this point, and the form of steam of course on the other side. So we showed earlier that we could bring the carpet up to temperature. This is temperature versus time, and you can see that the different positions, one of the variables we had to work out was how high above the carpet that we had in mock nozzle. So this is looking at positions and looking at the temperature rise and how much it held over those number of seconds to show we could indeed heat it up very, very quickly. These are the conditions that we use that in the. So this is just the formulations that we used. Mohawk Industries was the plant partner on this one. This is the steps that we used in actually preparing the sample all the way through the drying and home dryer, and of course we had to measure the color. This is one of the results where we're looking at the color difference between the dye sample and the regular steam sample that we're using as a standard. And as you can see, we're getting with a steaming time of about, steaming time of about 180 seconds was standard. We were able to match that, in this case, the medium shade on both the face and the back. Mohawk insisted that we match both sides. So we went through several arrangements with this, several variables. Finally ended up with an optimized setup after looking at different variables here with the mock nozzle. And then finally, these are some of the results. The red lines, of course, are the standard steam materials. And then we got the pre-steam with the mock nozzle numbers here. You see all the C-lab lightness and color difference, et cetera, up here to show that we came in as suitable with matching. And then finally, the conclusions of this work are very straightforward. We pre-steaming with the mock nozzle significantly reduced the required dye migration fixation times in the steamer. And the recommendation we made to the industry is to we'll speed it up 2.5 to 3 times the speed that they're using now, which it was ago. We looked at the increase at 10 yards a minute up to about 30 or 40, so it would more closely match what's being done now with lightweight carbon. So it has been proven to be a viable alternative to what they're doing now, and will eventually lead them off of batch dyeing, even on heavy-duty residential carbon. One idea we've also given them, we didn't have the research funds to continue it. Chuck Carr is a heat mass transfer expert, and he thinks we ought to move the mock nozzle from just in front of the steamer entrance into the steamer itself. In other words, have it just inside the steamer. And that way he thinks we'll get more efficient heat transfer and we'll have less environmental problems with radiation if we do that. So that may even improve this even further. All right, next area, PVA science, recovery and reuse. Kishore Gupta was a PhD student on this. This has been published again in the AATCC review. And slashing, as you know, is this type of process. PVA starch is still the most common blend that's used, although there are some systems out there that we can recover PVA, especially what we're looking at this time. How can we improve on a regular ultrafiltration reverse osmosis path that we're using now to recover PVA? And these are some of the opportunities that we see. Hot water, of course, in desizing and so forth, very, very high, as you see here. Pollution load, of course, when you've got starch involved, is very, very heavy in terms of the amount of VOD load that you pull in on that. So ultrafiltration has, in the last 15, 20 years, given us the ability to go to a PVA high wax formulation and completely recycle using reverse osmosis. This is just some of the details of those type systems that are out there. And disadvantages, though, are pretty straightforward of those reverse osmosis systems. You see those acetate films for the membranes. They do degrade, they do foul. System has to be shut down periodically to clean them, and they have to go to full replacement about once a year. They do do require high pump pressures. Force the water molecule through the film, let everything else go out very, very high. And the low molecular tail of PVA actually passes through the membrane. By the time we started working with West Point Home, they had one of these UF systems in, and the only way they were using the hot water they were generating from it was in makeup water for the very dirty shower washes. They got frames to put it back in dye baths and those kind of things because of that low molecular tail potentially interfering. So that was another thing that we looked at, is how can we improve on the system. And we went out and looked at what was available. We didn't want to try to develop technology from scratch, but we tried to find the technology that was already out there and already commercial that simply hadn't been applied in Texas. So this is the route we went, back and forth operation. The company was Vacon. They had a number of operations around the U.S. in different industries, showing that it was commercially viable. And it basically is a phase seal that's operated under pressure. So you go into the phase change of water under vacuum, I'm sorry, not pressure. With a boiling point of about 70 degrees C, and you can generate very, very clean samples of water coming out as well as recovered the BFA. So this is the BFA unit that we modeled here. This is a picture of one in operation. So Vacon was very eager to work with us. They never thought about applying to textile operations. This is the first time for them. So this is the advantages that we saw by going through the process in terms of recovering not only nice, clean, hot water that you can use anywhere in the operations, because PVA, of course, is not volatile under these conditions. And the objectives then was to study the ability to do that, to use VFE techniques to recover PVA size and reuse it a number of times. And these are just the objectives continued. So in the sake of time, let me move on over. We've got about 5 minutes. The research was divided in 3 parts. We had to worry a little about the effect of impurities. In showering, desized rub, you do take off about 2% by weight of cotton impurities. In other words, they all don't weigh the scour. There is some that come off there. Effect of wax and impurities plus wax, and finally the pilot scale up going from there. So this is the pilot scale up we developed at a bench level at Tech. That's the laughing over there. He knows how innovative these sheets are. But it did allow us to slash 2 ends of yarn just to get some stuff to test. And it'll work very, very well. So experimental, this was the type setup that we had with those two. We then, after we got the results from that and convinced ourselves that we could do it, Ian Harden was gracious enough to allow us to come over to the University of Georgia. He had put in a 30-end pilot scale slasher from Germany. And we were able to do a pretty good scale up trial there, go to larger volumes. These are some of the outlines of what we did. We did determine on the glass scale work that we needed to keep the impurities lower than about 60 to 50% low. We did that by adding fresh virgin PVA, so that was a limitation of the process. This is a picture of the process and operation. We then give you just a little bit of the yarn properties. This is ground yarn. We were working with towel materials out of spring finishing out of Griffin. And as you know, the ground yarn has a higher level size, about 10% on dry solid weight. Towel yarn had only 3 or 4%. So that's why we got 2 graphs here. This is the number of slashing cycles. This is the size add-on that we're able to generate, show that we could maintain it. This is yarn text versus slashing cycles here. This is the purity versus desizing cycles. And by the fact, again, that we could add back a little bit of virgin PVA, we would again show that plateaued off and didn't give us any further problems after about 4 or 5 reuse cycles. This is loaded break versus slashing cycles. And you see we maintain the low fine. Tenacity versus flash recyclers, again, we'll be able to match what we wanted to. Modular, same thing. And then abrasion cycles. Abrasion is very, very important. We're using a Ruby web tester to test that. And again, we're satisfied with the results here. So conclusions, BFE, worked well with about 2.3% of the arm weight for these size of cycle. Impurities built in. Apparent blank weight average of recycled dioxide decreases as impurities are lower weight to the BPA. So that's what caused an apparent overall drop in molecular weight, simply the dilution that the impurities have on the BPA. Flash arm tenacity, of course, was fine. Work with rupture initially increases, but then level off. And finally, flash arm elongation break slightly decreased after the third cycle and held steady after that. Hairiness, which you always have to worry about, was fine. Abrasion cycles more or less came in line with what we wanted. And finally, the bending length was important, especially on the power yarn, with that tuft that you gotta get, was also fine. So with that, I'll close it up. And as I said, the rest of the slides will be on A-Square posted there on the site. So with this, I'll call it to a close and see if we have any questions. We've got a few minutes of questions. Harry.
You said there would be 25% of the spent dieback still in
the goods.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's fascinating. What did you do any studies on how many rinses it would take, or what is the solution for that?
We didn't change the rinse procedure. We still use the same procedure as they use on single valve dye. So we did look at that. Frankly, as we showed on the impurity slide, that basically allowed us to reuse valves. The fact that we were sacrificing 25% each time, this allowed those impurities to just continue to build up until they caused the dye to be in the tunnel. Any others? Yes.
On sizing, with modern day weaving machines, high speed weaving machines, is sizing still important?
Yes. The shape of the yarn, the fabric of the yarn is still important. Because you've got the same soft start advancement of the yarns that are putting force on the yarns. And if you don't have size there, good size, you're going to be abrasive. We also have the same lineup of warp yarns coming through, things like hells, drop wires, etc., that give you a lot of abrasion. So those two reasons, yeah, safety yarns, especially cotton safety yarns, we still have to have a good slashing. And the general level that everybody's using on warp yarns is 10%. The only disadvantage of that is we saw in power yarns and towels. They have to use only about 3% because if they don't use 3%, it gets too stiff and it can't get the loop in the loop.
The reason why I asked the question is that, you know, being with a company in China, they're actually moving away from sizing because they find with their new modern equipment, the quality of light sizing, surprisingly enough, is better than with sizing.
Mm.
And of course, there's no effort treatment problems with sizing.
I hadn't heard that either. Everybody we're working with still using the same level of size they always have, even with most modern machines. Any other questions? I didn't do that good job. I don't do that. No questions?